Welcome you.
And hold on to that.
Right, for those who've not been here before, I tend to flannel on for about an hour. I'm going through this. This is the bare bones, which is sort of the pattern of what we're going to do tonight.
Excuse me, Bob. Do you want
me to
come over here and then Bob can
sit in that chair when you're
sitting here? Do you mind? All right, Matt. Thanks, Lee. Sorry, she thinks of everything.
Could you just give those back to me? Thank you.
Right. Has everyone got one?
No.
No? There you go. Right, so I'll talk for about an hour and then we'll have a break for tea and coffee and whatever. And then when we come back, we can have questions. But if there's any sort of a question, anything you're unclear about as we go rolling through, please say it's quite informal. And if you can't see or you can't breathe for me, if you just let us know, we'll try and open the window or...
Or
we'll all laugh, or you know, we'll do something. Okay, just to start us off, I put a quote in here. Essentially, the talk I'm doing is drawn around this book, which I picked up. I was listening to a Tolly lecture on the tag taking, and he mentioned this book, which is a fairly recent translation of the Tao Te King by a fellow called Stephen Mitchell. And your last page here. The very last page, it's on the back of the back, is a big chunk, a big quote from the foreword of that, because I thought it was very good, and it's a sort of nutshell of what we're going to do, so we'll get to that at the end. It's a very good interpretation. I've had a Tao Te King since I was about...
First came across
it. Almost knee-high to grass, when I was about 19 or 20. I first came across him because I was studying art down in Stoke. Yes, they do art down in Stoke, it's true. And we were talking about Jackson Pollock and the whole idea of Pollock and a great deal of the abstract expressionists was that the time, the very moment that we're in is quite unique. And the roots of these artists, there was the work of Jung, who talked about a thing called synchronicity. The fact that as well as being able to trace the meaning or the potency or the power of this moment from the past, what led up to it, and into the future, what follows on from it, there's also a slice right across time, which he calls synchronicity, the fact that things happen together. And the whole universe seems to be express itself in all the tiny things that happen in any now moment. Okay? So that someone like Pollock, when he's dripping his, you know, Jackson Pollock? They used to call him Jack the Dripper. He painted with tins of paint, literally, and he would throw and splash paint across a canvas. And it seemed to be very exciting stuff when I was sort of 19 and 20. It seemed amazing. But I was always fascinated by just how beautiful patterns like that were. I'm still hooked on it. If you look around you, there's what are called tape patterns here with the Chinese wood. So these flow patterns, which are, of course, the growth patterns of a tree, are all the way around you here in the paneling. As far as I'm concerned, it is literally the captured moment of that living thing responding to the universe. It's beautiful. There's no meaning to it, other than the fact that it seems to be a natural response, you know. And a lot of us are like this. We like our genes that are battered and washed out, rather than them when they come straight off the brand new. In fact, you can't even buy them sort of darkly stained anymore. They actually come already weather-beaten for you. I remember talking to my dad once about this, and because I got a pair of jeans, and they didn't look like the cowboys did, you know, and I didn't like them very much. And he had first come across literally American jeans in the Second World War when he was on board ship, and he said the sailors didn't like them either. They're too new, and they used to tie a rope end through them and throw them over the side for 4 or 5 days, and then when they pulled them out and washed them, they were already worn in. So they've always been better worn in. That fade, that the hit of sunlight and the hit of wear seems to give them a character, you know. And that fascination, that involvement with art, that you can make a splash that seems completely quite unique. And yes, it seems to be meaningless. You've just thrown or dribbled paint on a canvas.
Yeah.
But the uniqueness of it, the nowness of it, and the just-so-ness of it seem to be beautifully done. And luckily, the art lecturer I had said, this is sheer Taoism. If you read the Tao Te Ching, it's all about this very moment and how the whole universe is expressed in every one of its movements, in every one of its moments. The whole universe is here and now, doing everything at once. And we'll talk about that as we roll on, because to get to the Tao Te Ching, I'm going to come to two other discussions from Chinese culture, which I'd like you to take on board, because I think it'll help you to understand the Tao Te Ching a little bit more. Okay? And I'm starting with a quote from Einstein, which is just quite a telling one. Okay, it's from an article, and he's talking of the scientist, you know, or what he considers to be the scientist. His religious feeling takes the form of a rapturous amazement at the harmony of natural law, which reveals an intelligence of such superiority that compared with it, all the systematic thinking and acting of human beings is an utterly insignificant reflection. Okay? That is what we're going to be talking about tonight. Taoism is of that opinion. You know? That which reveals itself in the moment is an intelligence of such superiority that compared with it, all the systematic thinking and acting of human beings is an utterly insignificant reflection. This feeling is the guiding principle of his life and work, insofar as he succeeds in keeping himself from the shackles of selfish desire. So this is Einstein speaking and saying that the best scientists have got to keep themselves from the shackles, literally the chains, the tying up that selfish desire imposes upon us as human beings. It is beyond question closely akin to that which has possessed the religious geniuses of all ages. Okay? That's the quote, and that's the where it's from. Now, what he's talking about there, that harmony of natural law, which he says, you know, is this fascinating that when you slice open a tomato or whatever, you're looking inside, you see structure, you see pattern. You know, it's basically the same in all tomatoes, but it's uniquely different in each one. And yet, it has also a thusness about it, you know. Spent a lot of time in art school drawing things like tomatoes and cabbages cut in two and all sorts, and they are fascinating. And the more time you put into them, the more they seem to be just right, you know. People who arrange flowers, etc., people who literally spend a great deal of time designing anything, will tell you there's a justness, a rightness about things that they just have to balance. It's a dynamic sort of harmony. And if you move one thing, you have to move others. I mean, teaching art to kids, I used to get them, particularly abstract art, because the old kids are terribly conservative. You show them a piece of abstract art and they say, what does it mean? What's it about? You know, can't get anything from it, say, don't like it. Doesn't look like anything. You know, so you say, okay, well, let's cut some shapes out on a piece of paper. Okay, I want you to put one on a piece of paper. So they put maybe a circle on a piece of paper. I say, okay, move it round until it feels as if it's in the right place. And they start doing that, and you know you've got them. Okay, now cut a square out. Put a square on the piece of paper. Put that in a nice place. Do you have to move the circle? You know, so they move the circle and they put the square on. I say, okay, is that in the right place? Can you put it in a different place where it feels good? And they'll start moving it around. Then you give them, okay, so let's cut about five shapes out. Circle, maybe a banana shape, something else, something else. Put them on the paper so they look right. When they've done that, it takes them about 10 minutes, okay. Move one. Do you have to move all the others? And they're hooked. And you can take a whole, you know, you can get a whole lesson by just moving bloody bits of paper around on a square. Then you say to them, is it important where you put the piece of paper? And it is. It becomes important once you find the right place to put the circle on the square. Okay? Here you are. I'll show you. If we've got a frame, which I'll admit is unreal situation, but if you've got a frame and we put a circle here, does it feel right? How many people are quite comfortable with that circle being there? Hands up if you're comfortable. Hands up if you're not comfortable. Okay? So it's already got attention. It's created attention in that space. It feels dynamic. It's doing something. Okay? Now, if I'm going to balance it, does that balance it there? No. Okay? What does that do? Does that do anything to them? Does it link them or does it separate them in some way? Now notice that you're feeling some very abstract symbols. They don't really represent. That duck's a bit like a banana. And I had mentioned bananas to you before, so it could be my unconscious pushiness thing. But relatively objective, you know, they're not subjective images. They're not, in that sense, representational of anything, and yet you already have got a value to them. Would anybody like to put something else in there just to balance them up properly?
The umbrella needs a thing.
Stick?
Yeah.
Now, you called it an umbrella, so you've got to put one of those in. Does that feel better?
Yeah.
Okay. When you're doing that, you're literally playing about with tension. You could actually say there's a balance system here. But if you say it's a balance system, it's quite sophisticated because you've got distance too. It's very difficult to see that as a flat thing. You will have that at a certain distance from the picture plane, and you'll have that at a certain distance. That could be enormous and a long way away, or it could be right up close to the picture plane. You're composing a picture. Yeah? Now, after a while, you can get quite involved with this, because it has a harmonizing effect on you, or a distorting effect on you, just like music does, just like poetry does, just like dance does. You have inside yourself your own dynamic, which is telling you whether it's right or it's wrong. Now that arrangement can have a justness and a rightness about it, and you see in natural forms there's a justness and a balance to them, when particularly the way trees grow, and where you can actually sculpt trees and make them look even more right because they've been distorted by some sort of damage. You can actually enhance them with more damage. It's strange the way you can work with these. And if you leave them, they will grow around the problems that you've given them. That's the sort of thing we're talking about. Okay? And since I got a fairly consistent involvement from most of you, I know you've got that level of creative involvement with things, and you can see that that can capture a mind for an idle few moments, yeah? So it's important, the things we live in and the things we live with, you know? I go around and move the ornaments, and about 2 hours later I found they've all been put back. There's some sort of magic force in the house that arranges them into a different shape, you know? It's like if you, you know, drop a wet towel on the bathroom floor, it disappears, and there's a dry one comes back. It's magical. I don't know how it happens. It's like nature constantly writing itself. Yeah. Right. So that's the same level of order which he's talking about. Now, what that nature of that order is what we're going to be talking about. But the fascination with the fact that it exists and that it's a part of us, as well as a part of the world, is what the Tao is all about. And I'm saying, okay, and one or two other people are fitting in with me, okay? I'm going to start off with a quote from the Tao. This, alongside them, I've always put the verses. The Chinese language is written in pictograms. It's not written in words. We assume that they're words, and they're not. They're pictures. So it's rather like the hieroglyphs. You will get, I think this is one, it's called Boom. I think that's Boom, and it's a bird ascending. If you can see a bird ascending, they can trace it back and show you that originally it was a drawing of a bird flying upwards. Okay? So that's, if you like, a Chinese pictogram. It will be birds rising, birds flying upwards. What that means will be whatever it's linked with, other forms will be tied into that, to make it into a concept, not into a word. So birds flying upwards can mean startling, disturbing, disruption, joy. Can you see all those things? All linked up to birds going upward. Now, they're playing about with concepts. So when you come to translate Chinese into English, it's very, very difficult because the words are fluid and they're emotional. That's an emotional concept as opposed to a word. So in translating them, you'll find that every different version of the Tao Te Ching is slightly different. Similar, but slightly different. I like this one. He seems to have translated it, which is in tune with me. But even the first few ones I read, which are quite different, they still caught me. They were still saying things which seem to grab me and suggest things, rather than say things definitely. And the Tao Te Ching doesn't really say things definitely. What it does is it suggests things, and it catches your interest. Okay? So I'm starting with verse 25. I think there's 70 odd of them, little verses. They're written out like poems, but of course how they are in Chinese is they're pictographic things, and some of them are longer and some of them are shorter. There was something formless and perfect before the universe was born. It is serene, empty, solitary, unchanging, infinite, eternally present. It is the mother of the universe. For lack of a better name, I call it Tao. Okay? This is a man. Legend calls him Lao Tzu. We don't know for sure. The tradition has it that it was a man called Lao Tzu who wrote this book. And it was written some 2,500 years ago. It is still very often translated and it's still consistently published all the time. To have written something which still catches people, to have written it 2,500 years ago, is quite something. I deal constantly with Shakespeare for my sins, and people are amazed when you can say the best playwright we have, the one who is most consistently performed, the person who is consistently performed around the world and has been for the last 400 years, is writing in English that most people can't understand. 400 years ago he produced plays which we still get a great deal from now. They're retranslated, they're copied, his language has been swallowed into our language. To go back 2,500 years and write something which still hits people and still captures them is quite an achievement. Most things that were produced then have faded away. We know that human beings must have found a use for this to keep repeating it. So it's a distillation. It's never fixed, it's never formed, and it's quite vague, but it catches you. There was something formless and perfect before the universe was born. So we can imagine this as Big Bang, if you like, or between before everything, anything that we know was created, there was a something which you can't really describe. And there isn't a word for it. And the reason they would say there isn't a word for it is because, as far as the Chinese philosophy was concerned, there was this something which separated itself out into two things. A positive thing, if you like, or a strong system, and a broken system. Before that, there was only this thing which separated. You can describe this in terms of that, you can describe that in terms of this. The thing that was there in the first place, you can't describe in terms of anything. Because it was nothing before it separated itself out. If you like it, I've drawn arrows on that because it pushed itself apart and separated, it created two things. And that's why you have this wonderful thing that they talk about in Indian metaphysics, non-dualism. You've got a dualism there. You've got a feminine, if you like, and a masculine. You've got a positive and a negative. You've got actually a separation of something which is yielding and something which is strong, and they've been created out of something which is neither. It's neither strong nor is it yielding. It can't be because it's both things simultaneously, and you can't talk about anything which is everything simultaneously. because there are no words to limit it. Does that make sense? So they talk about the thing that was there, the non-duality that was there beforehand, because it wasn't really a one thing, because if you've got one thing, you've got outside and inside the same thing. So to call it a one is not quite right. There was nothing outside of it.
I suppose this is why in Advaita Vedanta it said God is not two.
Yeah. They don't say he's one, they say he's not two. And the Godhead, if you like, what they say is there was something, and then there were two things, and then there were 1,000 things. Because what happens when these two things multiply and create everything else in the universe comes from that. Okay? They're not saying that that is how the sequence of creation happened. They say, literally, that's the way our minds work. That's the only way of approaching the problems of what's there. Science has a horrendous problem. They're far more rational than the rest of us who believe in all sorts of crazy crackpot things. But they say there was nothing, and it exploded. And it created the Big Bang, out of which all this stuff came. And before that, now they're talking about just before the Big Bang, when everything must have condensed itself into what they call a singularity, which means a point, a start of the whole calculation. Before that, what was there? Well, there wasn't time, so the question doesn't make sense from the scientific point of view. And as far as the Chinese are concerned, it doesn't make sense in any conceivable way because our minds can't get a hold of it. Does that make sense? You've got no handle of separation. If you call that dark and that light, or the other way around, as they would probably do, you can describe one in terms of another. You can have shades of grey, but you can't divide something which is neither coloured in that sense.
What's the Tao Te Ching say about time?
What does it say about time?
Yeah. Because in modern physics you've got the infinite regress, haven't you? Something banged. So you had to be something to bang.
Yeah.
So where did that come from? It just goes back and back and back and back and back. So it doesn't resolve the problem of time. But the Tao seems to be timeless?
It is. And it's always now. Because, of course, it doesn't accept that. What it accepts is it's doing that all the time. It's immediately, constantly doing that all the time. Because, in essence, the essence of the whole thing about the Tao Te Ching is that it is inside us. Now, we're going to have to talk about the fact that we're dealing with something which is a tradition here, and we're interpreting a tradition, and we have to be careful. in other words, it's tied up with words which can be translated and distorted. So the word Tao literally means the way. That's the way it's usually translated into English. But it's far more than that, because it also means the road or the best way. It almost also means the process. And it's used like this in Chinese, in everyday Chinese. It means all of those things. And if you've ever done judo, that do is the Tao. It's the Japanese form of Tao, and it means the way of Jiu, the gentle way. Karate do is the same thing. It's another process. It's a way. It's a channel. It's a way of proceeding. So it's a common everyday word. And really, that translation itself, we have to look at is what we're interpreting and what we're projecting onto this Chinese word. Even the Chinese have struggles with it, because the pictogram is difficult to analyze in terms of ancient Chinese as well. It's slippery, and all the traditions are associated with it. Okay?
It is said to be a pathless path, isn't it? Isn't that right?
Well, it's a pathless path in the sense that it's not there until you tread on it. Okay? So, in that sense, it's pathless, but it is a way. So it's a process, if you like, of the whole thing moving.
The Chinese, I think, is one way, go with the flow.
Well, you're jumping way ahead of us here. We haven't got that far. Why are these things are important, and we will get there, but I think we need to come through the Chinese culture just a little bit, because there are things which I think directly play a part with it. So if you bear with me a bit. That symbol, by the way, there is It's a fascinating symbol. You've seen it probably lots of times before. Apparently there's lots of footballers who've got it tattooed on their bums as well now. I don't know why.
On their bums.
It's supposed to be what we just described. But the whole thing is neither black nor white. It's neither positive or negative. It's a bit of both. But it isn't separated like that with a black and white, and a contradiction, if you like, an opposition. Its opposition is extremely snaky. Now, if you draw that properly, this line has exactly the same size as that line, which has the same size as the whole circumference,
which is fascinating,
because these things have both got the same amount of edge as the whole thing. It's also, at any given point on the thing, it's always got some white and some black in percentages across it. What it's saying is that nothing is either completely black or completely white. And in terms of time, when things are getting extremely black, and extremely black, born in the middle of the black becomes the white. When things are extremely white, totally white, and getting so white that suddenly in the middle of the white is born the black. Hmm. And the reason I've gone for that one there, which is spherical, if you look at it, it's shaded. It's toned because when I was reading up on this, I came across a wonderful statement, which is just to say that it was to do with I Ching, which we're going to get onto in a moment. It was to do with the fact of divination. Divination is a strange concept, that you can actually do something which will reflect how the future is going to play out for you. That's the whole idea of divination. And people have been divining ways of future, whether it's tarot pack, whether it's throwing dice, whatever it is, in many different ways. And the Chinese had a unique system called the I Ching. And the potency of it was the fact, I wanted to get that spherical thing, because it says this thing, the way the universe is rolling, actually wants us to find out. It wants us to discover the way it's rolling. It wants us, in other words, to participate with it. It wants us to be creative with it. And I've represented it there as that sort of swollen sphere, if you like, because what they're saying is, if you allow yourself not to be trapped in your own thought processes, not to be trapped in your own selfishness of being you, this thing will constantly play through you in the world creatively. Okay? And that's a wonderful thought. Mm. It is to me anyway. Mm. Yeah? That if we open ourselves just a little bit, this thing will enter in the whole play of life with us, and we'll enjoy life a lot more. Okay? Right. Chinese philosophy is usually expressed in aphorisms, brief, concise observations of a principle, truth, or sentiment. Now, their philosophy, in that sense, is not like ours. It isn't hammered out logically, or it certainly wasn't in the early days when the Tao Te Ching and the I Ching were being written. Their words are not abstractions like ours, but pictograms to evoke rich images, all of which can easily be lost in translation. So we're dealing with something which is slippery. It's general and vague. It's a suggestion rather than a statement, okay? The very first verse of the Tao Te Ching is, the Tao that can be told is not the eternal Tao. The name that can be named is not the eternal nature. So it's starting from the point of view that whatever you can talk about isn't the big thing that I want to talk about. The book is about that thing, the Tao, which was there before anything else. And it's saying right from the beginning, you can't talk about it because it's eternal, it's infinite, it's complete. But we are going to talk about
it. It's also called a path. I mean, I find that intriguing.
Yeah. Well, that's one of the meanings of the word Tao. Remember, he said that thing, you know, for lack of a better name, yeah, I'm calling it the Tao, the way, the process. Because whatever you're going to call it is going to misdirect people. So he's saying, we're now going to talk about it, But try and go with the spirit of it rather than, I'm not going to nail it down because I can't really nail it down. It slips through your bloody fingers.
You can't limit the limitless.
Can't limit the limitless. Well said, yeah. Okay, the Tao Te Ching was written or is attributed, we don't know, and recent modern excavations have suggested that there was no such person as Lao Tzu, or he was several people. So it was written exactly the same thing as they say about just of any writing before about the 15th century. The Tao Te Ching was written or is attributed to Lao Tzu, Lao Tse is another way of saying it, and indeed is usually referred to in China as the Lao Tzu, so the book is called after, named after him. Tao Te Ching means, the Tao means the way, or the path, or the process. Te means the power, or the successfulness, or the virtue, it's usually translated as. So we've got the way of power, and Ching means classic. It's about the book. The book is the classic of the power of the way. Okay? In China it's just called the Lao Tzu because it was supposed to be written by him. Okay?
I think it means the old sage.
Sorry?
Lao Tzu means old sage.
Or old boy.
The old boy, yeah.
It's a colloquialism.
Yeah.
So again, it's like, was that really a character? Was it a type of character? Scholarship, as soon as the scholars start to look for it, it sort of disappears into tradition, so we don't know. He was a contemporary and a counterstroke in many senses to Confucius, the great philosopher of order and sequence. Now, a good friend of mine, Don Lord, used to say, was very intrigued. Don Lord, some of the people here will remember him. He was a very interesting speaker. He's still ticking over in Northwich over at the moment. And he actually spent a lot of time learning Chinese, learning ancient Chinese, so he could translate the Tao Te Ching himself, for himself, because he said it's just so slippery and there's so many different meanings to everything that you come across. And he said the great thing that they used to say about Confucius, he was such a stickler for order, for sequence, and for getting the priorities and the manners right, that if his mat wasn't straight, he wouldn't sit down. It is said that he was one of the advisors to a king. We're talking about a China that was a whole network of small kingdoms. We would call them probably tribal chieftains. They were strong characters that controlled an area. He was an advisor for one of them. And the story was that he was born into poverty. He rose to authority in this man's kingdom because he was such a good organizer. And he was in the tribe he was in was warring with another state. And the other state, it just shows you how fiendishly cunning these Chinese were. The other state, to get rid of the leader, they didn't attack. What did they do? They sent him racehorses, beautiful women, and spices. It says within 3 years the kingdom was on its knees. Can you imagine? Confucius decided that he had to leave because the place was falling apart. No one was taking his advice. But he couldn't leave then, he had to wait, and he waited until he said he was being insulted so on such a large scale, he couldn't leave without showing to the people that he was really upset. So he chose to leave on a very minor thing. I think he said that the quality of paper or something wasn't good enough, so he allowed himself to leave purely because he couldn't work. He then travelled around China. Again, the aphorisms he wrote are still quoted now and used now. The writings he produced are still read as being good government. And up until 20 or 30 years ago, up until the Great Red Uprising, the Chinese Imperial Guard would read his story, would read his stuff, analyse his systems. Just like the British diplomats would study the Romans, Tacitus and Martial, they'd study the Roman guys. They all spoke Latin. They all read about how the Romans governed, as a way of guiding them. Just the same way the Chinese study Confucius, okay? Now Confucius was all about order, how the best way of behaving within the family. The family is the center of Chinese culture, in that sense. A lot of their philosophy is based on how the family should be organised and the hierarchy that should move throughout the family, and the city, the state, the country should all follow the way the family and it's organised. And he was the one who allowed that out. So he was a man of great laws. I say he's the counterstroke to Lao Tzu, because Lao Tzu was the one who came along and said, well, actually, if you follow laws, you're limiting yourself tremendously. You can't be creative. You cannot make anything new. And you're limiting the whole of human potential. And he said it with the Tao Te Ching. So you've got this Confucius creating this tremendous order of rituals and process for the great lawmaker. And alongside it, you've got, or coming out at the same time, you've got Lao Tzu. And there are dialogues between the two of them. So they are supposed to have met. Again, these are traditional dialogues which have been written there. We don't know for sure. But certainly that is the way that they are traditionally represented. Okay? Confucius set out to codify the already ancient Chinese culture. Chinese culture was considered to be 3,000 years old when Confucius started to do this, 600 years before Jesus was born. Okay? There's a wonderful book called 1547, which starts off with the fact that it's written by a British naval officer. I'm sorry, I haven't researched this, but this is coming out of the back of my mind. It starts off with the fact that when Henry V was getting married, he had 30 guests to the wedding. They ate off bread, a thing called a trencher. When you talk about a trencherman, they ate off a piece of bread. Very few people had plates in those days. The king had allowed sort of 20 plates in the whole palace. 30 people were invited. They stayed for 2 days and they feasted. The Emperor of China at the same time was getting married. He had 3,000 people to his wedding. He built palaces for them all to stay in. They stayed for 3 months. Peking, or the celestial city, was 4 times the size of London. The book goes on to say he ordained so that 100 ships, which were 4 times as long as any of the galleons that we had in Britain, and he sent them out to look at the world, to bring stuff back. The whole book, called 1547, is about the fact that these 100 ships went out, and he's concerned, and he's a British naval officer, that we found them in Australia, Antarctica, that they brought back plants, you know, drawings of things like kangaroos and stuff like this, that the Chinese did this. And when they came back, the emperor said, well, there's nothing out there that we need. Let's build a big wall around China. Stay put. It's a fascinating book. Until I read it, I was amazed at the sort of things. They see them supposed to have mapped Antarctica, which is fascinating when you think of, you know, we hadn't even got to America at that time. Yeah, so it was fascinating stuff. Right. So, there was a very old, very established culture. Very, very advanced, supposed to have invented gunpowder, restaurants, metal roads, all sorts of things like this, which we now take for granted. And they were able to build the greatest sort of architectural thing, the Great Wall of China, which was apparently was produced in something like about 20 years. So, awesome thing, amazing. Sorry about that, but those facts are just literally my mind running. They're not things I've actually researched. Okay, just some aphorisms by Confucius. Merely because we tend to think that, you know, if we're not careful, that people didn't understand civilization 2,000 years ago. When you read these guys, you said that they certainly did. You know, they were very, very savvy. Some aphorisms by Confucius, which still stand today. Ability will never catch up with the demand for it. Okay, that's a pretty good one. I was amazed that that still could be applied to our government, I think, now. By three methods, we may learn wisdom. First, by reflection, which they would class as meditation, which is noblest. Second, by imitation, which is easiest. And third, by experience, which is the bitterest. Okay. There's no such word in English as bitterest. But they used it, so I used it. Okay, it should be more bitter, but it's got more edge if you say the bitterest.
Yeah.
I think by that, you know, it's pretty good. You know, you can meditate and find out about wisdom, which is the noblest. Yeah, it's great to have worked it out for yourself. Second, by imitating somebody who you think is noble and intelligent. And third, by experience. In other words, when the world hammers you that hard, that you realise, you know, you've got to get a grip over things. Choose a job you love, and you'll never have to work a day in your life.
I like that.
It's true.
It's marvellous, isn't it?
Very true, yeah.
Yeah. Everything has beauty, but not everyone sees it. Again, I think they were pretty... So we're talking about a guy who was, I think, very intelligent, and had sussed out quite a lot of things. But in terms of the counterstroke to Lao Tzu, you've got the balance point, both... alive together. Lao Tzu was considered to have been older. Both came from nothing, or considered to have come up through the ranks, so to speak, in a culture which was lots of little kingdoms in a vast country that was that big. Most people never ever saw the sea. Of course, they were just miles away from any sort of border. Okay. Here's a quote from Fritz Capra from the book called The Tao of Physics, which was written about 20 years ago. And the basic tenet of that is that the Taoist principles, which the Chinese had written some 2,000 odd to 3,000 years ago, are starting to become frighteningly predictive of what modern physics is all about. What I would say to that, and a lot of other people would say, is that's because of the way the human mind works, the way we look at processes, the way we find things out in information. There's only so much the way we think influences the whole range of how we can actually see the world. This system, I mean, when Tony said before about the fact that when you go back to precedent, you must go back to the Big Bang, what happened before the Big Bang, because nothing can't just explode unless that nothing is an extremely sophisticated nothing. St. Thomas Aquinas said that people criticize the fact that we put God as a creator. The creator of the whole thing always has to be outside the system. The system cannot create itself from inside. Whenever you go back in your mind, you must put a creation, the first exciting cause, if you like, the thing that flings everything into being, must be outside of the thing it flings into being. That's the way our minds work. And St. Thomas was quite clear about that. He said, yes, we say God creates everything, but if you don't say God and you take him away, you've got to put something else there. Something else which is outside the system to kick the whole thing going, because that's the way a human mind thinks. So we go all the way back to the Big Bang and then say, well, what was there before? It must have been something that generated the whole point. To say it all came from one point exploding doesn't seem to satisfy us logically. Okay? So most things have a system in front of it.
But then only until you say that time's an illusion, that's the only way around it, isn't it?
Well, what you'd have to say is you can say that the whole process is constantly creating itself simultaneously all the time, in which case time is an illusion, but it's a very valuable one in structuring the way we work. People who say that time is completely an illusion are often the most organized people, you know, and they carry a diary with where they are tomorrow, what they're going to be doing, and they even have a logical sequence of argument which follows from a beginning and leads on to a conclusion. So the whole nature of our minds are that we have sown inside us a time sequence which seems to be able to process us for the way we take in information. So to say that, you'd have to drop all those things. I think Einstein said that time is proven by three things. He says things last for a certain amount of time, things happen simultaneously, and what's the other one? Things happen in sequence, that's right. So those three things. So if there was no time, nothing would last for any length of time, no two things could happen together, and there could be no proper sequence, he says. So in other words, everything would be perfectly still.
That's pralaya.
Pralaya, or, yes, the Hall of Forms, if you like, as it's called in Celtic mythology. So if you're thinking about a timeless sequence, remember, nothing can happen in a timeless situation. It all is immobile, according to Einstein.
Well, that's logically, yes, but if you step outside logic, I mean, it's there in the symbol. Look at the symbol. The symbol is both moving and timeless.
Yeah.
All at the same time. It's really, really beautiful.
Well, it's only moving because you're moving around it. It's actually quite still. So you can say it's moving, but actually what you're doing is probably your eye beams are moving around, but also your mind is taking in certain aspects at any point. Now, yes, this is a very ancient concept of eternity. Mm-hmm. The eternal is everything that can possibly be, and we're moving through it, so we have time, but God doesn't, because he's eternal and he's everything, all there waiting for us to go through it. So you can do it that way, which is almost the same as the Tao. There's the whole system already written. Remember, it says in the Bible, the Alpha and Omega are already there, waiting for us to move through them. But something is moving, which creates time. Uh-huh. So you see those Islamic patterns are the same sort of process, or this is a pattern, or any field of pattern structure, it's an eternal field, and we go through it as it were the things then which are living in time. So we'll be saying, okay, at any given moment, Tony is there, and Alan is there. You know, so they're both exploring time, and he's going this way, and Alan's going that way, but actually the whole thing is perfectly still. It's timeless, but we are both experiencing time because we're moving through those eternal forms, which are still. So I'm seeing tomorrow when it comes, and you're seeing a different tomorrow, and then next week is a different thing altogether, which is already waiting for us in the universe to get there. It's already there. And that would mean that at any point we might be able to tune in to what's going to happen tomorrow or next week, or pick up vibrations from it, because it's actually there in the universe waiting for us to get there. Which is a very similar idea to the Tao.
Is this the Akashic Record?
You could call it the Akashic Record, yeah. Because the Akashic Record is, again, all the possible forms in the universe which is there waiting for us to actually embody, to make energized.
But depending on the pathway you choose.
Yeah. Akasha means... Akasha is a case. That's what it means. It comes from the same root as the word case. So it's outside the case or outside the box. What is always outside the box, the whole thing, is waiting for us to literally energize it and make it into a case, to make it into a box to live through, and then move on to the next one. So the Akashic field is that process which is not trapped in physicality yet, and it's still vibrating for us to get there. So when someone says they can feel what's going to happen tomorrow, well, I mean, you can predict from logically that the sun should rise about a certain time. We know that there are certain patterns of procedure, and that, you know, most of them are fairly standard, but something untoward will happen tomorrow, otherwise we wouldn't need to watch the news at 6 o'clock.
Yeah, I mean, you're making it very rational, but it seems to me that there are times when we can all just feel the timelessness of things.
Well,
and it's right there, but you can't take that and do anything with words and everything, which is what the Tao Te Ching is attempting to do beautifully.
Yeah.
So it's always paradox.
Well, we can say a little bit more than that. Well, it is always paradox, but what I want to do now, if possible, is go on just before we actually come to the Tao. Mm-hmm. I want to have a look at a thing called the I Ching. Now, the I Ching, usually spelled like this, and we've already come across the Ching so far, it means classic. So the classics are literally this, change, the E, often written in Chinese as G. So it's the classic of change. Now, very similar to the classic of Tao, of the way, the process, how things change. Based on the same system of the separation, this is called Yang because it's strong, This is called yin because it yields. Okay? Don't think that we're completely positive and negative the way we have that censure, because we have a positive attitude and a negative attitude. So we're censuring them already. What it means is this thing will allow change, this thing won't. Originally, they were a circuitry process in the fact that they were the dark side and the light side of a mountain. Okay, so this is yang, because the sun is shining on it and it's bright and warm, and this one is cold and damp because there's no sun on it. Now notice, as the sun moons over, they change. This becomes yin and that becomes yang. So the energy flows through across the mountain. So these processes, yang and yin, are meant to flow into each other. Okay? So these two things, which have been separated, will constantly flow one into the other. Is everybody with me on this so far? So they then said, okay, well, we've got these two things, combinations of those things, which are what makes the whole of the world. So the whole world is made of combinations of those. What they did next was, and it's almost like binary system, they said, okay, well, let's create trigrams. And you've got that picture there is, oh, I haven't used my pictures now. You see, you've been asking me questions, I've got all knotted up. There's Confucius for you, you see. So there's Confucius. Mm-hmm. He looks like a well-ordered citizen.
Yeah.
And these are the trigrams, okay? That's what they look like. That's how they draw them out. Stay there. Those processes, it's what you've got on your sheet there. Mine's a slightly different one. They said, okay, then as that spins, it will go through certain types of energy. Certain to do with this system of the circulation of energy through systems, we can build them up into positives and negative combinations, yielding and strong combinations. And as we do this, we can get certain sequences, and it will flow from one to the other. It will constantly change from positive over to negative. So you've got the completely yang, heaven, and the completely yin, earth, kun. Okay? So they're the two polar opposites of completely yang and completely yin. Let's turn that just a bit. Let me swim or wrestle. No, I don't think I can actually. I can put it there maybe a bit more. Right? Ah. How about that? Okay. So we've got literally the completely yang and the completely yin, and variations changing between them. Okay? So it's quite clear what they were trying to do. They then said, okay, so if you've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 of those, and we double them up into hexagrams. Hex meaning six, that's all. So instead of three lines in the trigrams, we'll make hexagrams with six lines. Then using those, we'll be able to predict how the world will roll. Now, this system of the I Ching is supposed to be thousands of years old. We've only really found examples of it about 600 or 700 years before the birth of Christ. We found them on bamboo. They were used for divination. In other words, they were used to see the future, but in a unique way. Now, these are very, very powerful in Chinese culture. Lots and lots of people use it regularly. A lot of people in the West use it regularly. How many people here have thrown Yi Jing? Okay. Absolutely. It's an extremely good system. Now, it's based on the fact that the universe wants us, we are conscious parts of the universe, it wants us to understand and to participate with the flow. If we open ourselves in any way, it will speak to us. Okay? So what I thought we might do now, just to explode, What you do is you throw something, a random event. They used to use yarrow stalks apparently, but everybody forgot how to use the yarrow stalk, so the yarrow stalk system was reinvented about the 12th century, and by which time everybody was using coins. So there's a coin system of producing a random event. Okay, you approach it seriously, you cast the coins, or the sticks, as you want, and you produce lines which are either positive, straight, firm, or negative, yang or yin, or also yung yin, which means they're very strong. If they're old, sorry, that's a yang line, yang. It's either strong yang, yung yang as they call it, or it's old yang, in which case it's about to change into its opposite, which is yin. So when you cast it, you'll get a line which is either steady yang or steady yin, or old yang or old yin, which means it's about to move into something else. And you can do that with three coins. Okay? Does that make sense? Shall we do it?
Yeah.
Okay, just to give an experience of it. I have my beautiful assistant over there who has even got three coins. Even on a Sunday, she's still got three coins, which is quite significant.
The coins are actually over there.
That's bad planning, isn't it, really? Are these them here?
No, they're
not here. Yeah. There's even a little purse. Yeah.
Why doesn't somebody over there throw the coins?
Why doesn't somebody over there throw the coins? Would anybody like to throw the coins?
It's your job. They're my coins.
They are her
well,
coins.
That's why you should.
Well, what we could do, we could actually have on. Six people, couldn't we? To throw a line each. How does that sound?
Yeah, go on then.
Okay, does that sound good?
Yeah.
It sounds interesting.
Do you want to do them all?
No.
Okay. John, would you kick us off?
Yes.
Okay. So, right. What it is, you've got either a situation of heads and tails. Which you choose, you have to choose beforehand what you're going to be. For me...
Hold on, they are heads and... Oh, sorry.
Yeah, for me, heads are three and tails are two.
Okay. Right.
Okay?
Yeah, okay?
That's the way I tend to associate with it and to form them out. So John was going to shake them in his hand and just throw a coin. What will happen is John will give us the baseline on which the whole hexagram will be built. Does everybody understand what we're doing? Okay? Yeah?
There would normally be a starting point, wouldn't there? Some sort of question or...
A question or something,
yeah. Yeah, I don't want to put a question here now, because literally we would get a reading then, which we could, would have to take in some way seriously. So I don't want you to form a question. We're just literally going to throw the thing to show people how to do it. Otherwise, we'll spend the whole of the evening discussing... because the judgments in the book, which we're going to read to you, are extremely enigmatic and will set your mind thinking, okay? These are things which have been written for at least 2,000 years, and the judgments which they give tend to set you off thinking. They are enigmatic and vague, but they'll get you rolling, okay? So I don't want you to set a question. We're just going to do it mechanically in that sense to see how it's done, because I think you might be... interested. John, would you throw the first one, please, and then tell me what you've got.
Right, so I'm saying the heads are three, tails are two.
Yeah. We've got two heads and a tail, so we've got the two heads add up to six, and the tail makes it into eight, okay? So what we've got is a strong yin line at the base. You start from the bottom up, because in Chinese, you build a very practical race, you build from the ground upwards, okay? First, would you like to pass the... Would anybody else like to go second? Mm-hmm. Stuart wants to go. He just likes to handle coins, that's all.
I'd count them when you passed on.
Two heads and a tail again. So I know what that one is. Now that's a strong yin, it's a young yin, so it's only just become a yin. It's going to be a yin for a while. And they would say it's not changing yet because it's holding steady. Anyone else? Liz? Okay. Three tails. Okay, three tails is six. Right, okay. So that's that's going to be, that's young yin, that's old yin, so that's changing. I'm going to put a cross by it to say that one's mutable. So that's a 6, and these two are 8s. There'll be a special reading for that because it's changing. So we've done the base hexagram, which we could see on this thing, and you can actually say what it is. They're all named after natural occurrences, or landscape features, if you like. Earth, thunder, radiance, lake, heaven, wind, water, mountain. And by heaven, they mean sky. It's the same on that basis. Okay, so we've got the bases trigram. Would anyone else like to throw forth for us? Please. I'm sorry, I don't know your name.
Peter.
Peter. Right, we've got 2 tails and a head. So that's 3, 7. Okay. 7 is a yung yin, a yung yang, sorry, a straight yang. So that's a strong line, so there's no mutability about that. That's going to hold. That's the first one. That's starting our next hexagram. Someone else, please. Okay. Hello? Okay. 2 heads and a tail, so that's 6, 7, 8 again. So we've got that one as Yung Yin. And the last one, please, anybody? Anybody who's never done it would like to have a go. Could you just go around a bit? I don't like to see my coins go out of sight. Two heads and a tail?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, 2 heads and a tail. That's 8 again, so we're okay with the yin. So now we've got 2 hexagrams, which, so 2 trigrams, which make a hexagram. So we've got 2 qualities which we can now find on a grid. V, can you tell us what the hexagram is?
The lower one is Kun, Earth.
Kun.
And Earth. The upper one is Zen, which is thunder.
Before you read it out, can I just say, even though we didn't ask a question, I suspect it's answering one. I mean, just because we didn't have a question in our rational minds doesn't mean there isn't a kind of a question that the group represents in some way.
Well, I would, you might say that, I wouldn't be bold enough to say that, because I've been severely told off by the Ching.
Have you?
Yeah, for not taking it seriously, so I do, you know, there are one or two in there which just sort of say, if you're not going to take it seriously, don't bother doing it. Virtually. Yes. Because, you know, what we're doing is, we're allowing the fact that this thing which created the universe is still creating the universe. It wants beings like us to be involved. Therefore, if we open ourselves in any way, most of you guys that I know have opened yourself in some way, you've gone down a creative line which allows you to move in a particular direction, and that particular direction is your way of tapping into that field. This thing is a general one, because sometimes you come to an impasse. Literally, you can't make your mind up one way or the other, and you need advice. Now, you can go to the superior man, as it calls it in the I Ching, the wise man, or the wise woman, if that's your particular choice, or you can consult the I Ching. In other words, it will take you into yourself and produce a process which will come up with an answer inside of you, just like a tarot pack would do, or a crystal ball. If you use a crystal ball very well, what you do is you project into this thing, which is misty or vague, images. You can sometimes see them in the fire. I used to read tea leaves at Tanigarth. You'd be surprised the number of people who would come back to me and say, that was spot on. I was reading tea leaves, you know, something to do. Mm-hmm. Because Ken wanted me to entertain people, you know, while, you know, he went for a fag or whatever it was he did.
Chocolate.
Literally, chocolate, it would be bounties. But it was literally to pass the time. But because you're tuning in loosely, it's surprising the stuff that comes up. Mm-hmm. Out of the mouths of babes comes incredible answers.
It's funny how subjective that is. I looked at that and I had a picture of the cockle pickers who lost their lives.
Right.
On the sand, and I don't know where that came from.
Well,
it came from somewhere.
A lot of yielding.
On stable ground.
Strong there, yes, you would say so. Receptive earth and sort of thunder above it. What's the reading, wise?
We're talking similar lines to psychometry.
Not psychometry in the sense that in psychometry you're tending to pick up a history that an object has had, yeah. Usually with contact with people.
Yeah.
So that's like, if you like, the word fluence was often used, but the spiritists say there's a fluence which hangs about objects and tells you where they've been.
What, residual energy?
Residual energy, yeah. For residual energy, read fluence.
Okay.
A stuff that stays with them, and literally you can pick that up if you allow yourself to be receptive to it. In other words, there's information which will come to you.
As we discussed last week.
As you hold things, yeah. I find metal objects particularly sort of resonant, but anything will do it. You know, buildings are supposed to be particularly effective.
Okay, it's number 16. It's called You.
You.
Enthusiasm.
Enthusiasm.
So, above we've got Chen, the arousing, thunder, and below we have Kun, the receptive, earth.
You first of all get the image, don't you?
Strong line in the fourth place, that of the leading official, meets with response and obedience from all the other lines, which are all weak. The attributes of the upper trigram, Chen, his movement, the attributes of Kun, the lower, are obedience and devotion. This begins a movement that meets with devotion and therefore inspires enthusiasm, carrying all with it. Of great importance, furthermore, is the law of movement along the line of least resistance, which in this hexagram is enunciated as the law for natural events and for human life. The judgment, enthusiasm, it furthers one to install helpers and to set armies marching. The time of enthusiasm derives from the fact that there is at hand an eminent man who is in sympathy with the spirit of the people and acts in accord with it. Hence he finds universal and willing obedience. To arouse enthusiasm, it is necessary for a man to adjust himself and his ordinances to the character of those whom he has had to lead. The inviolability of natural laws rests on this principle of movement along the line of least resistance. These laws are not forces external to things, but represent the harmony of movements imminent in them. This is why the celestial bodies do not deviate from their orbits, and why all events in nature occur with fixed regularity. It's the same with human society. Only such laws as are rooted in popular sentiment can be enforced, while laws violating this sentiment merely arouse resentment. Again, it is enthusiasm that enables us to install helpers for the completion of an undertaking without fear of secret opposition. It is enthusiasm, too, that can unify mass movements, as in war, so that they achieve victory. Want the image?
I think what we'll do is we'll move, since we've got a mutable line in the six in the third place, what does it say for that? What happened is when we threw that, it's an old yin line, so it's going to change into a yang next. So that's movable, if you like, so that's the thing which is fluid in the situation, according to the Yi Ching.
Okay, six in the third place means enthusiasm that looks upward creates remorse. Hesitation brings remorse. This line is the opposite of the preceding one. The latter bespeaks self-reliance, while here there is enthusiastic looking up to a leader. If a man hesitates too long, this also will bring remorse. The right moment for approach must be seized. Only then will he do the right thing.
Okay. Right, what we need to say about this is there you've got a judgment and you've got an interpretation of a chance random throwing of lines. What then happens is your mind engages with it. And as far as I'm concerned, it's your engagement and your attitude which brings out the value of anything that you've heard or read. That translation is by Richard Wilhelm. There he is there, a German guy, translated it from the Chinese into German. Jung was a good friend of his and considered that the translation that he gave was a very powerful tool for getting in touch with your own unconscious. Literally allowing your unconscious to come out and speak to you. In other words, you know what's going to happen, you can feel it. What you need is some way of bringing it to the surface, and these forms of divination allow it. Because they are vague and stimulating at the same time, they allow you to bring stuff from your deep unconscious to the surface so you can recognize it. Okay? So divination in that sense is a valuable instrument, but it's not something which is beyond yourself. Or it doesn't have to be beyond yourself. It can be if you interpret it that way, because the universe is doing this all the time. It's making things which are not present out of literally some, if you like, storehouse of images, forms, which the world constantly seems to be producing and unproducing, swallowing, if you like. The great gods of time eat their children. Kronos in the Greek mythology eats his children. We produce forms in this universe, and then the universe eats them again. Thousands of things die every, you know, having lived for seconds. It's fascinating. So I was only listening to somebody on the radio on Tuesday night talking about the great new cyclotron thing at CERN in Switzerland. It's producing things which last a millionth of a second. This Higgs boson, if they find it, will exist only as a particle for a millionth of a second. And they've got to trace it and catch it and photograph it in that time. It's amazing what we're talking about as being stimulant and creative in this universe. The small lifespan of this particular particle. It comes out, it literally collapses out of a field for such a minute millisecond of existence. Right, so we're again talking about translation. This is a German guy. It's translated into English from the German. He translated it from the Chinese. The thing about the I Ching is it's been commented on by many people over literally thousands of years, and you then read the interpretations which you've given to it. Why I'm telling it to you today is not to advocate it as a process, but as a way of thinking of how the Chinese literally approach the world. They see it as something which is rolling onwards. They see it as something which you can move with, you can get in tune with it. The whole idea of a Tao Te Ching is that you can get power by moving with the universe instead of resisting it and going against it. In other words, there are times when you cannot do anything if you go against the flow. It will sweep you away. You know, there is a time in the affairs of man which, taken at the flood, lead on to greater things. If you don't take them at the flood, as in enthusiasm has just said, you will lose the whole impetus of your project. It will go without you, or it will collapse through lack of energy. So can you see what the Chinese sort of culture is suggesting here? It's out of this that the Tao Te Ching needs to be read, because this was in effect for about 1,000 years before. Not just in China, in Rome, in Greece, the Celts used to use divination. They used it for thousands of years. To suggest that it didn't work is very strange. They were very practical people. If something didn't work, they didn't do it. They didn't have a great deal of free time. You know, they literally lived from hand to mouth. Everything had to work for them, otherwise it was abandoned. So they are very practical people, so are the Chinese. It must have given them something, and it is sustained. They are still using the I Ching. It's still used in business, you know. A friend of mine bought me a book which is based on it called The Art of War, which is a Chinese text which was written many, many years ago, and it's still quoted and used in business today. You know, the enemy of my enemy is my friend. Use the enemy of my enemy as your friend. All this sort of thing. It's the art of war, but it's used in business. It's the way to literally control situations, whether it's working with children, you know, working with unions. A friend of mine used to work with unions. He was a PR man. He used to work with unions all the time, and he was constantly using Chinese methods of diverting people's attention bamboozling them, we would call it, you know, literally using one thing to get to the other. Okay, just, are we ready for a cup of tea then?
It's getting close to that.
Getting close to that. Yeah. I'm just going to read the Richard Wilhelm translation here of the Book of Changes. He just, he makes a quote of it. I'm at the bottom of page 2. Of far greater significance than the use of the Book of Changes, the I Ching, as an oracle is its other use, namely as a book of wisdom. Lao Tzu knew of this book, and some of his profoundest aphorisms were inspired by it. Indeed, his whole thought is permeated with its teachings. Confucius, too, knew the Book of Changes and devoted himself to reflection upon it. As edited and commented by Confucius, it is the version that has come down to our time. In other words, Confucius read the Book of Change, he organized it, edited it, and commented on it. He gave his interpretations of it as well. He who has perceived the meaning of change fixes his attention no longer on transitory individual things, but on the immutable eternal law at work behind all change or in all change. This law is the original, this law is the Tao. This fundamental postulate is the great primal beginning of all that exists. Tai Chi, in its original meaning, the ridge pole, represented by the symbol of a circle divided into light and dark, yin and yang. The earliest meanings or terms are yielding and firm, or overcast and shone upon. That's Richard Wilhelm, this chap here, the German interpreter, who's interpreting the I Ching for us and producing copies for us in English. The first thing, it was retranslated into English from his development. The wholeness of existence is a process of flowing changes, traditionally developed into 64 hexagrams. The basis of this text is simply 64 explanations or events, each expressed by one of the hexagrams. When a hexagram is cast line by line, the I Ching is then consulted for insight into its meaning. That's what we've just done. Subsequently, many scholars have added commentary to the early descriptions. Over the side there are the hexagrams. Now notice they've been translated for the computer age, they're now written sideways. So instead of from the bottom up, they're written this way. So that same one would be written like this. So you could print it on a computer and you can get translations, and there's all sorts of stuff on the internet which you can use if you wanted to go into this a little bit further. Right, so we'll have a cup of tea, then we'll come back and dig into the Tao Te Ching. That's okay with everybody?
Yeah.
Are we ready, V?
2 minutes.
2 minutes, okay. Any questions then of anything we've come to or anything?
It seems that the inscrutable is vice and inscrutable. I say that carefully.
Absolutely, yeah. I thought you were going to say the inscrutable give rise to the scrotum, but
I thought there was that as well.
How old is the I Ching thought to be?
The I Ching book?
Yeah.
Well, nowadays they say, well, there's no extant evidence of it, no physical, tangible evidence of it, older than about 700 years BC.
Hmm.
Tradition puts it down to be the 2,000 to 3,000 years BC.
Hmm.
It's like the stories of Lao Tzu and Confucius. These people are shrouded in all sorts of legends, so we can't be sure what is actual and what isn't actual.
Mm.
But certainly the influence on the culture is profound.
Mm.
You know, they're found in all sorts of places. as they would have been, we seem to have lost touch with the fact of this, but from a subject which I know something about, the Shakespearean thing, the Globe Theatre was moved. The Globe Theatre was built out of oak. When they had plagues, which they had about every 10 years during the 16th and 17th centuries, the theatres were closed because the city ordinances would be run by mostly Puritans, would say, you mustn't do this, you're enjoying yourself far too much, you're all gathering together, you're all dying of the plague, close the theatres. Their way round this was to literally dismantle the Globe and take it across the river away from the city. And they rebuilt it. What we know from the theatres that we found is that inside of them were all sorts of astrological signs. Mm-hmm. When they inaugurated a building, they waited for an auspicious time. You know, the whole of Washington DC was built on very auspicious times. The whole idea of having a foundation stone is to say this is the birthday of the building. And that is always on an auspicious, because most of them was were masons.
Yeah, Freemasons,
and they were Masonic systems.
And they're all built in the northeast part.
That's you know, the influence that this sort of auspicious thing and the whole idea of gathering literally energy at a flood to create a building, to create a company, to create a situation is still potent within us, you know? So even if you don't believe any of these things, you need to take it on board because a lot of other people do and they use it constantly, you know? So it needs to be looked at in terms of a way of analysing a lot of the structures which are around us.
How often was this used? Who's used? Is it weekly or when someone feels the need for it? Or?
Well, I was always told originally, we had a teacher who said don't use it too often because it loses its potency in the fact, you know, like all things do. You then become, it then starts to be making decisions for you and it doesn't want to do that. It wants you to feel intelligently, and the ideal method is to feel the potency of what's happening next anyway. You know, there's a lot of writings in English about the fact that time is, as Tony mentioned before, a malleable substance. It isn't literally the tick of the clock. A lot of what we do now has been influenced by previous situations and seems to be leading on to situations which we can't even dream of yet, which we're building now by the things that we do.
Well, time is man-made anyway.
Well, certainly, well, the way we codify it is man-made, but wherever we look, you know, there are processes.
As a measurement.
Yeah. And in that sense, it's quite limited. It's quite limited because it's the only thing that's measured by itself. You know, we can't we don't have anything else to assess it by.
I mean, I choose to move out of time, to go into timeless.
Yeah.
You know, if you feel yourself becoming stressed, people are drowning under materialism, you know, and you go out and you get in this madness, then you can step out of the time process into the eternal within yourself.
Yes.
That releases you.
Yeah.
You know, from that. Then you can step back into time.
That's
when it's necessary. Yeah.
That's exactly. That's exactly what he's saying with that that thing, that this no thing which we have, the Tao, is inside us.
It's inside us. It's not different.
Yeah. That infinite eternal thing is not something which was there at the beginning and is not there now. It's still there, but it's underneath all that stuff. It's allowing yourself to not be caught up in the stuff that gives you access to that process. Now I would say that that's the essence of meditation, is to drop out and get a few eternal moments inside you. But then I would. Let's have a cup of tea and then
tea's
go back to refresh. Cheers, Liz. Thank you.
This is dulcet tones.
Too late.
Oh dear. Right, so now we're really getting to the we're going to come back now to the, we started off with the Tao Te Ching, and I just wanted to go through that because I thought that the context actually behind it is very, very important, because we need to literally absorb a culture which is different from ours, vaguer and softer than ours, no less successful for that, and a culture which was complete and in many senses more in tune with nature than ours is, certainly than ours is now, to be able to, if you like, get the flavour of what Lao Tzu was coming up to. Now, for the sake of literally understanding the system, if we accept the tradition that it was written by one person, then it's easier to come at the actual teaching that's coming across. Scholars will tend to fragment things because what they do to the Bible is amazing. You know, you shatter it into at least six different authors, if not more than that, and lots of it all written out of sequence, etc. You lose its coherency and it smashes into pieces. To get the broad sweep of it, assume for a moment that it is one character. Okay. I'm going to read the next one, which is the ninth one. Keep coming back to this because I do feel that it's actually meant to stimulate inside us the atmosphere of the Tao itself, the receptiveness to feeling into yourself, a process which is sensitive, still, quiet, and profound at the same time. And profound just means deep. There's no bottom to it. There's parts of you which are so quiet and so still, and so meaningful, but they don't say the damn word. And if you sit in them, you have the creative beingness that doesn't speak until you start to move, until you do something in the world, and then keep coming back to it, because it's not what you do in the world which is important, it's this depth that it's coming from, which is the whole essence of, I see, to meditation. You put yourself into this calm, still state, you understand that that level beneath, which is breaking through into the world and creating the world all the time, is the one you sit in. It's literally the creative part of you. And in doing that on a daily or well, more than daily if you can, basis, puts you in touch and opens this part of you, which, it's not a belief, it becomes a reality, and a very deep and meaningful one. Right, number 9, fill your bowl to the brim and it will spill. Keep sharpening your knife and it will blunt. Chase after money and security and your heart will never unclench. Care about people's approval and you will be their prisoner. Do your work and then step back. The only path to serenity. Normally you see with philosophy, we'd analyse it. We can analyse that just a little bit, we can take it back. But actually, if you try and grab hold of those things, you'll be able to find situations and say, well, no, that actually wouldn't work. But if you accept it as the feel, that vagueness or an approach to it. You know, I sharpen my knife on a regular basis, and it certainly does blunt. And it does feel as if the more I sharpen it, the more it blunts, because of course, I want it sharper and sharper than it can stay. And you notice then, you become very critical about the slight bluntnesses of it when it won't actually move and when it won't go through things. So yes, that is a point. It means you're focusing and becoming very, very distinctive about what's going on. But to chase after money and security and your heart will never unclench, I can see that as well, because you know we all know people who do get caught on it. You know, we all chase after money, we all need money and we need security, but when it becomes too important, it seems to self-destroy. It becomes the thing that you, instead, it's there to get things, the things themselves are far more important than the money and the security. It allows you then to play and to enjoy life. If you don't do that and you're still busily gathering, then you've lost the whole point and significance of it, you know? Do your work and then step back. In other words, there's a time to work and there's a time not to work. It's the only path to serenity. But of course, knowing when to do that and when not to is quite a subtle art, you know? Taoism, I mean, we've just been talking about the fact that these words are constantly being re-evaluated, or the way we say them has changed to be more in line with the way, of course, the Chinese speakers say them.
I believe that although there's only one universal or national set of pictograms, they're all voiced in a different way in different parts of the country.
Well, the two big ones are, of course, Mandarin and Cantonese, and they have the same written form, so they can read what each other's writing, but they can't talk to each other because they're said differently.
Might be married, really. Tried to talk it over, but the words got in the way.
Yes. Yeah. Well, a lot of people say that this is what St. Paul meant when he said that our conversation is in heaven. If we're, in other words, it's in the perfect realm. When you're conversing someone, when you're actually rapporting with people or rapping with them, and you're connecting, the words are meaningless. When they have voice analysis and they look at it, most people don't finish their sentences, and half the time you're not listening to what the other person said, but you understand the meaning, you're going with it, you know, and the body language is something like 85% of what of the communication that's coming across. So, you know, if you learn a foreign language, you realise that most of the time what you can say is largely limited, you know. I used to know a lorry driver who said, I said, how do you get on going across France and Spain, you know, dealing with all these people and the different police? He says, it's okay, I speak Desperanto. Represents the view that the processes of the universe, I'm at the bottom of page 3, nature and hence human society, all ethics, politics, language and knowledge itself are expressions of a flow or sequence of things, the Tao. So that any attempt to achieve Te, excellence, virtue, power, involves us in moving and flowing in alignment with this Tao, reflecting on its nature within us and in the environment as a whole. Lao Tzu, the old master, archivist in the Zhou dynasty, said by tradition to have written his wisdom for the boar, the gatekeeper, as he left for a life in the forest. In other words, he birthed in the archives of Zhou in this particular small kingdom. He decided to go back to the forest where he'd come from originally, and on leaving, he was sort of sneaking away. The gatekeeper of literally the end of the territory said to him, well, you can't go. You know, you're such a wise guy. Why don't you write something down for us? And he said, well, there's no way of actually saying it. And again, these are all traditions and legends. And the gatekeeper is supposed to say, well, I'm not going to open the gate for you unless you put something down in writing for me. This is how the Tao Te Ching is supposed to have been written for the gatekeeper as he snuck away. And from then on, he went off into the forest. What happened to him, we don't. Now, that's the tradition, and it's a bit of a Robin Hood story. So you can imagine that it's probably been embellished. But that is the way the Tao is supposed to have gone. So any attempt to achieve Te, the Tao Te Ching, the Ching is the classic, this is the classic book. Te is the excellence, the virtue, or the power. And Tao is the process. So your Te, your excellence and power, rests on you moving with the Tao, literally getting into the flow of energy. Lao Tzu, the old master, the archivist in the Zhou dynasty, said by tradition to have written his wisdom for the border gatekeeper as he left for a life in the forest. The oldest surviving copy is from the 4th century BC. Lao Tzu was, was contemporary not only of Confucius, but closely to Buddha, Mahavira, Zoroastra, and the pre-Socratic. Eckhart Tolle makes a big thing of this. He says that in this period, the 5th century just before the birth of Christ, across the whole of the ancient world, people started to talk about what nature, what being was all about. So you've got a heck of a lot of tremendous God people, if you like, or basic philosophy coming out there. Confucius, Lao Tzu, Buddha, Mahavira, of the Jains, Zoroaster in Persia, the pre-Socratics in Greece, including Diogenes, Pythagoras, Parmenides, and Heraclitus. Tolle cites this as part of a wave of advanced understanding in the 5th century BC. Right across the world, suddenly it started to happen. People started to talk about these things. I mean, he puts down the very same fact that, you know, now an awful lot of things which are being talked about, like the Tao Te Ching, would have been considered absolute mumbo-jumbo 40, 50 years ago, and 100 years ago, just absolute rubbish, meaningless rubbish.
Well, you were ostracised for daring to speak of
people
it.
People didn't even bother to translate these systems.
And just going back to what you were just saying about the Proctor, Eugene wrote a piece for us, my children were smaller than they're like 46 now. 45. Mm-hmm. They were little kids, and we were doing something at the Blue Coat in Liverpool, and he wrote about the wave of souls coming in, being more enlightened, teachers coming in a wave, that everything happened in waves.
Yeah.
It was the essence of this writing, and he's saying the same thing here.
Yeah. And Tolle actually, sorry, Tolle paraphrases the Tao Te Ching as simply, live in tune with the source of energy and experience who you are beyond who you thought you were. So in other words, underneath who you think you are, there's another level of you who you actually are, and you can tap into that, you can tune into that at any point. I mean, the nice thing about Tolle is he says, we keep putting it off and we've got to do it now. We'll only ever do it in a now. And there's always a reason for putting it off till next week, you know, when you've got a better car or you've actually finished wallpapering the bathroom. Because how the hell can you sit down and meditate properly, you know, while the dog needs a walk? In other words, you know, we put it off. And it's not us, it's literally the mind that won't let us go. Sorry, John, what were you going to say?
I was going to say that, could it be that these names are remembered purely because that's when the written word was started?
Well, most of those guys didn't actually produce written stuff. People did write about them, you know, but they actually were Buddha, you know, I mean, Jesus himself, Socrates, all these people never bothered to write anything down. They were too busy living in the moment. You know, they said things, other people wrote them down and thought they were wonderful, but not they themselves didn't actually write much. And of those Greeks, we've only got fragments. I mean, Pythagoras was very secretive about what he said. I mean, and he was completely involved in the whole idea of that shimmering. Pythagoras is basis of most of his theorems, and we don't know whether he was the one who developed Pythagoras' theory. There's no evidence that it's his. It's just tradition, again, which shows you that it's not just the Chinese who are vague about this sort of system. Things get stuck to people when they're not sure of it. There's no evidence he invented Pythagoras' theorem, but we do know he was terribly convinced of the geometry of the universe, that the universe is a geometrical structure which is like a jewel. It all depends upon itself, that mathematics is the whole route to understanding the whole cosmos. In fact, he said, don't come to my school if you cannot understand geometry. It was written above the door of the gymnasium where he trained people. And the gymnasium then meant a school where you went, you exercised, you meditated, you studied mathematics, you studied history. And his whole thing was the whole universe was geometrically structured, that you could work everything out mathematically. And this is the system of diet, system of processes. So what we'd have to say, he was definitely a cult, very secretive about all his processes. So again, a lot of this stuff not written down, but still talked about. And outsiders literally commenting upon what Pythagoras was getting up to and what their people did.
Did he see the world as a machine then?
No.
Or did he see it as evolving according to geometrical principles?
We'd have to say, into the idea of a machine, yes, you'd have to say it's a solid sonic structure. To him, it was created by sound, uh-huh. And that sound moves geometrically and creates the whole geometry of the world, uh-huh. Vibrating like different. Like those structures that are produced by patterns, you know, all the time. And that from that, we are moving through, literally, time is moving across the face of eternity. So any given person is moving in through that geometrical structure, living their life in a whole system which is laid out of possibilities. Mm. Every decision you make, you're moving through things. Very, very similar to the new form of alternate worlds, which is being postulated by physicists now. That every time you make a decision, a whole universe is generated to accommodate your movements. Parallel universes. It's fantastic, you know, when you think to yourself, there's not a shred of evidence for this, really. There's postulations, but there's not a shred of evidence, and no way of even designing it.
It's the same thing as the path unfolds as you take the step.
Yes.
It's the same thing.
Yeah. I mean, Eugene used to talk about the fact that there was a vast potential of all possibilities. Literally, what you're going to do in the next minute is a vast sea of potential. Whatever, you could do absolutely anything. You probably won't. You will probably go along the line of least resistance or the line which is laid out for you. But at any point in your life, you could literally go off at a tangent. People do. People decide, you know. And that's why in yoga and in all these esoteric systems, that choice, that point of choice inside of you, is the essence of being alive. Barnett Newman, to go back to those artists that were talking about abstraction, if you ever look at Barnett Newman's paintings, a lot of forms will be in there, colours merging, there will be a streak of very, very intense colour. The moment of conscious awareness he was trying to get at. I know, contemporary of Jackson Pollock and Rothko, people constantly moving into this meditative type of painting, getting back to the forms which are behind the forms that we see in the world. So that abstraction is a way of removing yourself from this tangible world just a little bit further back and getting at the motives. You know, if you sit in front of a Rothko, nobody you've ever seen any of the Rothko paintings, it is like a meditation on canvas. Nothing at all is happening, but it creates space, you know?
It's like a Sri Yantra.
Yes, yeah. It's very similar to that. Yeah. And if anything, it's just vaguer than that, and you feel that there's things forming in it. Yeah.
Alan, I think it's important as well to consider that there's an extreme practicality to this. I think if you contextualise Confucius and Lao Tse and look at them where they were situated in China historically, mm-hmm. you had like the fragmentation of the country to 800 kingdoms, and by the time you reach Confucius and Lao Tse you've got 16 or 18.
Yep.
And what's interesting, I've just noticed with the Greeks as well, these people sought the executive, both Confucius and Lao Tse. Their function in the community was to produce some systematization for the rulers.
Yeah.
And Confucius was a stoned ritualist, you know. You had to be, what's the Chinese? Tzu, gentleman. Yeah. You had to be a gentleman, not like Arjun, you had to be a gentleman.
Yes.
And I think the way I view these two things is Confucius, we need these rules, we need hierarchies, king, subject, husband, wife, father, eldest son, etc. Yes. And Lao Tzu went, well, to do that, to become a gentleman, you need to develop the way.
Yeah.
And just as a rider, the account of Confucius and Lao Tse meeting, apparently Lao Tse always won. I just thought you might like to know.
Yes. Yeah. The other thing, I mean, you, someone like Peter Curry would sort of say, the other thing is that we were also trying to contain powerful rulers.
Yeah.
So we, if we look at it, we could say that yes, the rulers were actually wanted to control the people and structures, but also the people wanted to control these powerful rulers who were literally power brokers. They would think nothing of wiping out the whole kingdom.
And I think they wanted to know why.
Yes.
You know, what?
Yeah.
There was 800 and now we've got it better. Is there a... because it's the natural human condition. Is there a system here? We can tweak it?
Yeah.
And this is like a dialectical position. We have order and we have intuition and...
Yep.
And that balance between the two is...
If you get too ordered, all the energy goes out of life.
Yeah.
And if we get too energetic, all the order...
You start smoking dope and having a good time.
Yeah, we've got Apollo and Dionysus, which is what was going on in Greece at exactly the same time. But they were also trying to work out what the world was. Literally, all these many various things seem to have some sort of commonality, some sort of structures within them. And the Greeks came down with mathematics, and what is actually said in the West is what they did, they accepted that there needed to be some sort of evidence of proof. If you know anything about Euclid and his geometrical systems, which are still taught today, I mean, what else is there that is still taught today as a basis? Euclid, it was formed, you know, more than 2,000 years ago, we're still studying it. The theorems which he wrote on geometry are still extant engineering forms now. The axioms of those were taken as true before they were proved. You have to believe in something before you start to find the evidence for it, and then you work back and prove the system. But there are some basics in that which are just assumed. But when you've got that, you start to create a whole network, and geometry means measuring the earth. It was to do literally with laying out structures for building, for making things that worked. They realized that maths is a hidden order behind the universe. Scientists are still studying it now. It's the essence of all medicine. It's the essence of all geography, psychology. They actually codify it into systems. So when Tony says, is it a big machine? It's a big mathematical machine. As Einstein says, it looks more like a big mind than a big machine, but it's all down to maths. And when they're trying to get the Higgs boson, they're trying to find out the last mathematical point that will give mass, weight, and literally momentum to this whole universe of ours. So it's still a maths-based problem, you know, and they're talking about multi-milliseconds.
And it'll have an Irish name. There's an irony for you.
Okay, right. Now, this point I've thrown in from Aldous Huxley here, it's about Descartes, because it also brings us back to it, just a little basic point. According to Descartes, when we consider the nature of time or the duration of things, from the fact that we are now, it does not follow that we shall be a moment afterwards. Okay, we're here now. There's no necessity that we'll be here a moment afterwards, unless some cause, viz., that which first produced us, shall, as it were, continually reproduce us, that is, conserve us. Descartes actually says, well, hang on, with all this actual, we're assuming that we're just going to continue. But if we are continuing, something is sustaining us, so we are inside of something which is sustaining us. This whole field of life, or whatever we're in, is actually allowing us to continue. There's no reason why something shouldn't just disappear, but it doesn't. Here we seem to have something analogous to the cosmic level as to that physiological intelligence which in man and in lower animals unsleepingly performs the task of seeing that bodies behave as they should. Indeed, the physiological intelligence, homeostasis is the medical word for this, may plausibly be regarded as a special aspect of the general recreating logos. Now, logos is the old Greek word, which was formulated by Heraclitus, to describe the way that whole system rolls through itself. The structure we were talking about was logical, that means mathematical, and logical comes from logos, which we translate in the Bible, it's translated as the word, but it actually means the system of order. So it's an ordered system that we're moving through. So it's actually geometrical, if you like, it's mathematical. It follows certain principles that you can actually analyse. Now remember, when we see the maths that we're told about the universe, when we know that statistically, you know, there's so many, the flow of energy, the choices that you make on a daily basis, even literally the way you find, you walk your way around, that Tesco's can be analysed statistically, and they can prove, you know, that literally come down to, but not as an individual, but as a group of people, how we shop, how we do, how we think, all these processes, so they can get to the point where they can actually pinpoint a spot on the moon and land something on it, you know, taking into account the variables of gravity, which they can structure. They don't know what it is, but mathematically they know exactly how it behaves. The geometry has gone to such a state now that we can actually put a spaceship that can go round the back of Pluto and come back and send television signals back to us. So right is the mathematics that these guys have analysed. You can't see it. You and I can't see the maths. You have to really analyse and smash away at structure to see any logic behind it. It took thousands of years before people noticed, you know, that water is made of hydrogen and oxygen. It's only recently that we discovered that. That two gases make that stuff you get washed in. It took a hell of a lot to get that. And yet it's mathematically held together. And the mathematical theorems that come from that are guiding satellites around the back of Pluto while we sit here. So that structure, there is a structure to the universe which we're finding all the time. That it's benign, that it seems to support our existence and allow for us to creatively be involved in it, is a stage beyond which science has gone. But certainly that there's an unseen and invisible structure is proven. And the more and more we can see about it, you know, so that they can pretty well tell statistically how long you'll live, what you'll die of, by just looking at your system. And they're saying that within the 20 years they'll have it down to within months. That's good news for you. This is the way it's progressing. This is what they're trying to do. Now, I would say that because this universe is more fluid than that, and because I believe that we have will, free will, then we can always interfere, throw spanners in the works. Hopefully. You know, that the system, that the whole thing seems to be natural and logical in this way, you know, he comes down here. In Chinese phraseology, it is the Tao as it manifests itself on the level of living bodies. That's Aldous Huxley speaking there. All right, a little bit more of the Tao Te Ching. The unnameable is the eternally real. Naming is the origin of all particular things. Oh, just before we got this, sorry, I missed out section 10 here, which I wanted to come to you about, because this is a lovely section which in Mitchell is very much about meditation. It's very much about stilling the mind. Okay? Can you coax your mind from its wandering? This is verse 10 or section 10 of the Tao Te Ching. Can you coax your mind from its wandering and keep to the original oneness? Can you let your body become supple as a newborn child's? Can you cleanse your inner vision till you see nothing but the light? Can you love people and lead them without imposing your will? Can you deal with the most vital matters by letting events take their course? Can you step back from your own mind and thus understand all things? All of those really are things to not do, ways of undoing. And that leads us into the wonderful thing in Taoism, which is called Wei Wu Wei, doing, not doing. There's a doing, not doing. There's a way of not doing, not driving forward with things, but allowing them to happen and fitting in with the allowance to happen. So it's not doing nothing. It can be very intense, but it's allowing and going with the way the energy is taking it. I can't separate it from the fact that one of the few things in life that convinces people that they're moving in the right direction is the way the coincidence just seems to flow with them. If a lot of coincidences are happening in your life, I would say you can't be too far wrong. You know, that is, to me, is when the universe seems to push you on your way and you're getting a free ride. It's like surfing sometimes. You know, things just slot in. You go somewhere and it's waiting there for you. Someone comes up and says, I've got the thing you need, you know. And there's no better. It just happens, and it can happen, you know, on a building site in Kirby. It can happen at the university. It can happen anywhere you like. And someone, you're in a hell of a state, you can't see the way out, and someone comes along and says, do you need one of these? You know, and it happens so often. You know, you sit there and you sort of say, well, I'm stuck here. I can't go any further with the things I've got. What can I do? Something happens and just takes you that stage further. Just, you know, something you couldn't have predicted. Even to the state where you'll spend all night worrying about something, and when you wake up in the morning and you go into work or the situation, you find it's melted. Overnight, the problem's gone away. It hasn't solved itself, it's just not there anymore. You can't find the pretty problem that you've been worrying about. It doesn't happen often, but it does happen occasionally.
Yeah.
And it's so satisfying when it does. It's magical. Okay? The unnameable is the eternally real. Naming is the origin of all particular things. Now this is again from that very basic thing in the I Ching. The unnameable creates all these, the thousand things. It creates the first two, and then from those two, everything creates. Whether you accept that as the generation, the sexual generation of beings, or whether you accept it as positive and negative, and the electrical generation of fields and stuff like that. What it says is, from there onwards, everything else can be understood, can be mechanically predicted, if you like, can be analysed. But before that is that, you cannot analyse that. You can feel it in your own heart. but you can't analyse it. So thought begins from there. Naming begins from there. Particularising begins from there. So you get one, two, and then a thousand things. It all goes bluff after that. But those two are the essential, and all things can be divided, can be polarised. Any situation you give, you know, when we were doing philosophy at college, someone gives you a problem, immediately split it. It's called the watershed. If you want to find out about something, give it a watershed. There's a watershed. The rain comes down, wiggle, higgledy-piggledy. If it hits, there's the watershed at that point. This rain runs down there, that rain runs down there. You immediately split every argument into two. For and against, positive and negative. Let's do it, let's not do it. You split it down the middle, and then you can have an argument between those two things. Philosophy does that essentially. Divide it in two, and then bring the two things together. Drama does it too. You have a woman that's going one way, a man that's going the other way, bring them together, there's a drama. You have somebody who wants to go forward, somebody who wants to go backwards, bring them together, you've got an argument. You've got a drama. Create a situation. Two people argue. One person on his own will argue with themselves. Should I do this or should I not do that? Do you know? For another person in the room, they'll argue with that other person. Get three of them, you've got a good drama going on between the three of them. Yeah. Two against one, one against two. You know? Watershed, it's the division of things. That thing immediately creates complexity, which we seem to love, but which embroils us and takes away from the unity. Constantly go from that into this. You can't understand this unless you sit back into that every now and again. Move into that, come back to that. Because this understands that in a way that this cannot understand itself. I remember Eugene saying to me, an awful lot of people when they retire, they stop doing things. What that means is they start to fight with their wives. If you're in a close situation, you've got to have difference, and the differences will come to the fore. If the two of you are against the world, you're together, the world separated. The distinction is us and the world. You create rid of the world problems, work, going out, making a living and all that sort of stuff. It's just you and me together, dear. People make the same mistake. And if they're not careful, if they don't literally find something to do, they will actually marmalise each other. And the same if you take a person on their own, will literally start to fragment inside, you know? The process is one of, we only hold together, literally, to engage with another system. It's the way things work. A wonderful guy called Kessler divided a system of whole arms. He said everything is a whole arm. This works beautifully in terms of the Tao. He said anything you can give me, I will tell you is made up of parts. And each one of those parts is a whole arm which is made up of parts. And each one of those is a whole arm which is made up of parts. And you have to say to somebody, which level are you talking about? And in terms of sciences, you can say, okay, we talk about biology. Well, hang on, biology is made up of cells. Okay, so we talk about microbiology now. We need microbiologists for this conversation. Oh, no, the microbiological cells are actually created out of chemistry. So we need a chemist there to talk about those state of things. And then we go down to the atoms. Then we need a physicist. So all these things are called holons, he said. They've got a face which looks upwards and they're unified from the top down. But every time you divide it, every part you divide is itself subdividable. So everything about you is made of parts. If you separate it from its hierarchy, this thing will split. It's only held together because of the function it does in that one, which is held together because of the function it does in that one. So these biological systems, we'll call them animals, are only held together by what happens to them in their environment. And their environment is only held together in terms of what the temperature and the climate and the weather is happening around them. So wherever you go, you've got something which gets its structure from above and breaks into parts for the things underneath. It's made of bits that get their structure from what's happening above it. Can you follow that? Mm-hmm. He said they're holons, and you're a holon. Your psychology is a whole on it. In dealing with other people, you're a unity. In dealing with yourself, you fragment. And each one of those fragments will fragment again if you look closely at it. And every time you look, you can split it, divide it into bits. And every time you divide it into bits, to gather unity, you have to come up the scale. To get unity, you have to come up to the next order. Because it's that which binds it together. Its function in the world, if you like, or its function to the next stage. And this is happening in companies. If you look down from the head man to the executives, to the next stage down, whichever it might be managers, etc., all the way down, they get their unity as a body from the structure that is above. Wonderful description of the way things fit together. Certainly with words it's very, very good. You can each find a word. When you're looking for words, you find that the closer you go back to the roots, the more and more you find words tie up together. So it's called subsuming things under different titles. So you find more and more about less and less. So that's a very interesting concept. It's Arthur Koestler who discovered it. He wrote the book The Ghost in the Machine, and he wrote a wonderful book about humour as to why things are very funny and what it is that makes us laugh in terms of released energy. The wonderful characteristics. But his book The Ghost in the Machine was very, very influential in the 50s and the 60s because it took very seriously the fact that we have free will. We have to. There's something in us which seems to be able to override all forces of materialism inside ourselves. And he was writing from the point of view that he'd been tortured by the Germans, and that what he constantly found was there were ways of releasing himself from the domination and their control. Even in a situation where they controlled absolutely everything, when they fed him, what they fed him, if they fed him, he could still, you know, there were still ways of actually bringing oneself out. And even to the point where they regularly used to threaten him with death, take him out, blindfold him, put him up. He thought there was a firing squad, and then they just leave him there. And then come out and take the blindfold and bring him back to his cell and say, we'll do it tomorrow. They were even that clever. And he managed to get around that. He managed to understand what was going on. Okay. Instilling the mind, at the top of page 5. Instilling the mind, the absence of normal thought processes and mental noise allows the awareness of something behind or underneath such processes. Something that, like a ground of being, is supporting and allowing all. Most of us don't separate from our thought processes. Now, number 2 from the Tao Te Ching. When people see some things as beautiful, other things become ugly. This is the watershed. If something is beautiful, there must be ugly things in the world as well. When people see things as good, other things become bad. Now, this is one of the things which many philosophers have said, that since good is defined by evil, reality itself is neither good nor bad. This thing out of which everything was created is a different kind of good altogether. It's something which is beyond good and evil. It is pure being. In your essence, you're neither good nor bad, because both of those are words which describe different qualities in terms of each other. You can only describe goodness in terms of its opposite, badness, and vice versa. And one, in that sense, is created by an absence of the other in every situation. So this thing here must be in some sense beyond and above all those scales. And we'll qualify what we consider to be good and evil, which allows for a great deal of forgiveness and, for want of a better word, love, in dealing with situations which seem to be incredibly destructive. Being and non-being create each other. Difficult and easy support each other. Long and short define each other. High and low depend on each other. Before and after follow each other. Therefore the master, Stephen Mitchell's very good about this. He translates the master in his version as being masculine or feminine, because he said the original Chinese word is neither male nor female. It means the superior being. So he's translated it half the time as male, half the time as female. Excuse me. Therefore, the master acts without saying anything, and teaches without saying anything. Things arise and she lets them come. Things disappear and she lets them go. She has but doesn't possess. She acts but doesn't expect. When her work is done, she forgets it. That's why it lasts forever. So there's no attempt to put your name on anything that you do. No attempt to assume responsibility for it, no? It's like the old concept that the Greeks had of a muse, you know, that artists didn't create things, the muse created through them. I've got a friend who constantly talks about his idea and his ideas, and you think to yourself, well, where do these ideas come? They must come from everything you've ever discussed and listened to and heard, and what happens is it forms inside you, but it forms of itself. You know, it just comes to you. It's given. You know, most of the things, you know, that I've claimed responsibility for were sheer happy accidents. I no more created them than flew to the moon. It popped into my head and I said it. And, you know, either got patted on the back or somebody took a swing at him. Because sometimes it's good, sometimes it's... But the creation of it, it's magical. It comes from the unconscious. And to say it's yours is really very difficult. It would be very, very rare for someone to literally construct something, you know, bit by bit, nail it together and say, there, I did that. You know, just doesn't happen. There's so many accidents. I was talking with Gary before about joinery. The number of times I made horrendous mistakes in joinery. And one of the guys that worked with me originally was a guy called Arthur Eves, and he said, joinery, the best joiners are the guys who can cover up the horrendous mistakes they make on a moment-by-moment basis. You know, the number of times things go horrendously wrong, and you think, how the hell am I going to get out of this? Look what the hell I've done to this door. It happens on a daily basis. You just learn very, very ways of covering your mistakes. This house is full of them. Don't look. Okay? When her work is done, she forgets it. That was the one which really resonated with me. When her work is done, she forgets it. That's why it lasts forever.
That's non-identification.
Non-identification with the products. You know, enjoy the work you're doing it, because that really is now, here and now. When you've done it, don't cling to it, you know. Allow it to go, you know. Allow it to go. In the first translation into any Western language, the Tao was taken in the sense of ratio, or supreme reason. Stanislaus Julien decided that it was impossible to understand by Tao primordial reason or sublime intelligence, and concluded that the Tao was devoid of action, of thought, of judgment, and even of intelligence. In fact, he seems, without saying so, to have made the word synonymous, as it doubtless is, with Nirvana. Finally, he translated it as a way, or the way, in the sense of I am the way, the truth, and the life. That's Richard Buck, talking in Cosmic Consciousness. The Tao is called the Great Mother, empty yet inexhaustible. It gives birth to infinite worlds. It's always present within you. You can use it in any way you want. There's something comical about Lao Tzu. You build something up and then just throw something in. It's almost like a haiku. The last bit really resonates and makes you rethink everything it's just said. The Tao is called the Great Mother. Empty yet inexhaustible, it gives birth to infinite worlds. It's always present within you. You can use it any way you want. You know, and that immediately gives you... it's like the ball is in your court. There you go. There's the ball. Run with it. Well, what are you going to do? You know, it's infinite. And it's you. It's inexhaustible, and it's you. It's the Great Mother, and it's you. What are you going to do? The Tao is infinite and eternal. Why is it eternal? It was never born, thus it can never die. Why is it infinite? It has no desires for itself, thus it's present for all beings. They're talking about this thing here, which is constantly feeding the whole universe. The Master stays behind. That is why she is ahead. She is detached from all things, that is why she is one with them. Because she's let go of herself, she is perfectly fulfilled. Those who try to control, or who use force to protect their power, go against the direction of the Tao. They take from those who don't have enough and give to those who have far too much. The master can keep giving because there is no end to her wealth. She acts without expectations, succeeds without taking credit, and doesn't think that she's better than anyone else. My teachings are easy to understand and easy to put into practice, yet your intellect will never grasp them. If you try to practice them, you'll fail. My teachings are older than the world. How can you grasp their meaning? If you want to know me, look inside your own heart. Okay? Right. Nice thing from Eckhart Tolle, he talks about it. You're in the universe. You're not in the universe, sorry. You are the universe, an intrinsic part of it. Ultimately, you're not a person, but you're a focal point where the universe is becoming conscious of itself. Okay? And this last bit, which is 20 past 10, so I'll just read this last bit. This is the bit which is taken directly from the book. It's from the foreword of the book. And it, if you like, it's a wonderful presse of what we've done tonight, I think. About Lao Tzu, the author, there is practically nothing to be said. He may have been an older contemporary of Confucius, and he may have held the position of archive keeper in one of the petty kingdoms of the time. But all the information that comes down to us is highly suspect. All he left us is this book, the classic manual on the art of living, written in a style of gem-like lucidity, radiant with humour and grace, and a large-heartedness and a deep wisdom. It's one of the wonders of the world. It's clear from his teachings that he deeply cared about society, if society means the welfare of one's fellow human beings. His book is a treatise on, among other things, the art of government, whether of a country or a child. A good athlete can enter a state of body awareness in which the right stroke happens by itself, effortlessly, without any interference of the conscious will. Sorry, this is a paradigm for action, non-action, wei wu wei. The purest and most effective form of action. The game plays the game. The poem writes the poem. We can't tell the dancer from the dance. Excuse my typing, I was drunk, I can't help it. Less and less do you need to force things until finally you arrive at non-action, when nothing is done and nothing is left undone. Unencumbered by any sense of sin, the master doesn't see evil as a force to resist, but simply as an opaqueness, a state of self-absorption which is in disharmony with the universal process, so that, as with a dirty window, the light can't pass through. I think this is a wonderful metaphor at the end.
Look, so it's
dark. Yeah. Right. Oh, actually finished it. That's pretty good.
That was excellent.
Thank you. Any thoughts? Any questions? Any bits?
No,
or bobs?
No, it was very brave of you to undertake doing the this. I think. I don't know whether it was folly or what it was, Al.
I think it was folly. It usually is. It might come right in the end, but it's usually folly. Prompting. Thank you. God bless. I hope it is.
It is.
Fiona, sorry, you wanted to say something?
All it was is a purely practical thing. I think, are there any spare sheets? Because I'm missing a page, I think.
Oh! Yeah.
I've got one here.
Oh, brilliant.
Great.
Thanks.
I will check.